This is 92, 93 graduation. You're feeling better?
Cheese.
Then say cheese.
Cheese.
Oh, ma'am. I come peaceably tonight. Hello, Billy.
Gotcha.
Are you getting
them on paper? Right, so. Cheese.
Your turn. Babe, you stand up here behind. Does he need to take his tie off, probably?
Let's see. Open
my
shoes.
No. Wait, we'll see. Well, them long
sleeves ain't there. Okay.
Good chop.
Okay, go sit down for a minute.
Stay there with him, Linda.
Squat down behind him.
This little booger?
No, you stand
there.
Look here.
Daniel Dome, honey.
Devo? Put your hands down.
They're wonderful teachers, Miss Linda and Miss Nita. Miss Linda helped us, the largest graduating class in the history of Sugar Grove, three graduates this year from high school. We introduce them now. Megan Cooper. Daniel Tierney. Matthew Schaefer. Jonathan. Hey.
Yeah.
this early age in their life. What a blessing. Also, we'd like to announce that our high school graduates can read.
Amen.
Thank you for being here. And we'd like to introduce now our graduates of the ABCs of ACE. To go together and give Miss Carla a special award. Miss Carla had an unusual senior year. She only worked, I think she finished in the first quarter, didn't she? She finished her work in the first quarter, so she didn't have a lot of academic statistics this year to really be in the running for the other awards. And she finished up in the first quarter, and then she became our secretary here at Sugar Grove. And what a job she's done. Not only a secretary, but Brother Clyde, who was the supervisor with us this year, could not be with us full time. He's attending college classes on some days, and so some days Miss Carla came out into the Learning Center and worked as a supervisor. Sometimes she worked as a monitor. She's done it all this year, and she's done it all with a very sweet spirit. And so we have tonight, I think, a very beautiful plaque for her, and it says special award from the staff at Sugar Grove, Carla Burks. Your godly character, faithful service, and sweet spirit enriched our school. And we mean that. So, Miss Carla, would you come and receive your diploma?
Thank you. And it's with you I share my diploma. see what we mean now. If you didn't know Carla, you see what we mean now about the sweet spirit. This next young man, I believe if you could take the word of determination and turn it into a person, it'd be Jody Lacey. I got to tell something here that is absolutely true. I did not think he would graduate. I know I've been accused of using reverse psychology. You know, that's when you tell somebody they can't do something, so they'll go ahead and do it. That's reverse psychology. But I honestly did not think he would make it. He had too many paces to do, and they were hard paces. Some of them were very hard in business math. And he had a limited time. He was working his senior year. He worked in Owensboro. I kept trying to get him to quit his job. He wouldn't do it. I said, quit the job and graduate. You're not going to make it if you don't quit the job. I wanted to meet with his parents. We couldn't get together on a meeting, but I wanted to meet with him. And without Jody, and just tell him he's not going to do it. Don't get your hopes built up. He won't make it. And I meant that. I thought that. I would try to encourage him. And I would try to say, do your best. He'd say, I'm going to do it. I'd just say, do your best. I'm praying for you. And I was. I didn't think he would make it. And he made it. He came up to the very last in his work. You see, this is a school like most people never heard of. You don't get a diploma from this school until your course of study is completed. We don't give a diploma if you lack one pace. We've always said that, but we never dreamed we'd ever have to face that decision in reality. But it looked like maybe we might have to face that, a student lacking one pace. You see, when we started the school, we heard about some schools who they would go ahead and give the diploma even though the student had not completed the work. And say, we got back late and complete the work. And then we heard that some didn't make it back to complete the work. And so Brother Eddie and I decided that the only way we could give out the diploma on graduation night is if the work was completed. And Jody worked last night till 4 o'clock in the morning to complete his final business math pace, came this morning and took the test. Some of our people prayed in the night. Literally, they prayed, took some hours and prayed for him during the night. And he came this morning and passed that test in business math. The diploma that he's about to receive is an earned diploma.
Yes,
sir. Let me tell you that. He earned it. And what determination he has. You know, America tonight needs some men who are determined.
Yes, right.
We have too many men in America, males in America, with no backbone,
right.
No determination whatsoever. They're blown about by every wind. This young man has some determination.
Yeah.
And he's shown us this year, I might add this, last night we gave out the award for Christian character. And Brother Kenneth Calloway won that, and I'm proud of Kenneth, and I think he deserves it. But Jody tied with Kenneth. And we in first place votes, and we had to go to second place votes and count them to determine the winner. He came that close. He proved his character to us this year. We love him. And we're proud to present this diploma to Brother Jody Lacefield.
Taking my place at work tonight so I can be
parents, actually, they really do care about you, they love you, and see you do your best. They're praying for you, they care. Thankful for Brother Clyde, boy, he's really been a blessing. And stayed up with me a lot of times in life. And it's been rough, but we did it, man. See, I've really got a lot since I've come back, and God's really opened a lot of doors. Sticks out in my mind in the learning center. Many times I'd come by and find a note that he had written to me. He had an appreciative heart. And he'd write this note and he'd tell me how he appreciated me and what I was doing for him. And Billy always signs his notes in his steps. That was his favorite book of all the books he had to read, other than the Word of God, his favorite book in his steps. If you've read that book, you probably know why. And our prayer tonight is that Billy will walk in his steps. And I believe he will. We love Brother Billy, and we're proud to present this diploma to Billy Mitchell.
Down, you know, acting all all sad. She always had a smile. And I always wondered why that was. Until one day I seen him, he was down in the basement. And I think Brother Stephen just called our break, and the little ones were just coming back in from theirs. And I saw Miss Gary come out of the kindergarten room. She had her Bible in her hand, and a tear coming down her cheek. She'd been in there spending time with the Lord, and I could see why she had the smile on her face all the time. Right. She knew where to get the smile from. She knew who to go to. And also, thanks the Lord for Miss Burks. I guess they call Ralph Rice Mr. Enthusiasm. She'd have to be Miss Enthusiasm. She always kept us going, kept us smiling when we was down. And she was always there. I guess she's probably been here the longest. The video, and she's been gone some, but she's been there pretty well most of the time. And thanks the Lord for Mom. She's worked here off and on over through the years, grading tests and being a monitor. I thank the Lord for her being there. I see Miss Jackson sitting back there. And I can say something about but I just thank the Lord for all you monitors that have always been there. And for Brother Clyde, although he was just here this 1 year working with me, but he's such a help, and not only helping the school, he was a man of God. And I mean, I can say that, not even think twice about it. This, one of the first things that's always on his mind, when we go to trip somewhere with him, one of the first things he'd do, whether it be to the attendant at the gas station or someone just asking directions, one of the first things he'd ask them is if they knew the Lord as their Savior. And I thank the Lord for that. I thank the Lord for someone to set an example for us young men and for the young ladies to always have a burden for souls and to stand up for souls. And I thank the Lord for my sister. She's worked here for 3 or 4 years in the school, and she was always a help, not only here at school, but at home when I'd come home. And Brother Stephen, when they saw me here, I was pretty well cheered over here at school. But she saw me at home, and I'd go home and throw the eyes of her face across the room and say, I'm quitting. She said, no, let's get this back together and work on a little bit more. And I thank the Lord, she was always there to help me. And I thank the Lord for my mom and dad both. As Carter said, working, praying, helping push me through school. And a lot of times they had to push to get me to go. And I thank the Lord for them always being there. And I don't mean anything to Brother Steve or Brother Eddie, but I think right now, I thought about it a lot. Trying to think of something to say. I didn't know exactly what I wanted to say. But I think I'm kind of the privilege for me to have the biggest hero of my life right now. Maybe somebody else coming later, but the biggest hero of my life is sitting right here in this room. And it's my brother, Jimmy Benson. There's not been a time they would come in, but him and I would get off somewhere and have a talk. It wasn't about baseball or basketball or anything like that. It was about the Lord. And he's helped me more than he'll ever know. Just stick it and keep on going. So like where Jeremy Burby is in the corner, my sister Medina, and but one when it's a song after the beginning that they all and that for Jeremy to sing this song, it's just a song where they just talked about a lot. But it's just a simple way to say thank you. That's the name of the song. And I want to thank you all for being here and for the support you given to the school over the years to help to keep warm. I want you to know that I love you. And that I love you.
You were there with me. You were said, you may not know me now. Then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. One day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. That was changed. Test to see how they're doing, and I'm happy to tell you they have an education.
They've completed our course of study. You may be seated. I'll turn this over to Brother Eddie and let him welcome you and introduce Brother McGee. And I just want to say I'm so glad Brother McGee's here. I love him. I guess the feeling of the whole school could be summed up in what my 7-year-old son said today. He said, "Dad," he said, "if I lived in Louisville," and that's a long way for a 7-year-old. He said, "if I lived in Louisville, and the only thing going on tonight was Brother McGee preaching," he said, "I'd come."
Yeah.
He's going to go sit by Brother McGee now. I'll turn this over to Brother Eddie. Has come out tonight to be with these graduates and all your grandmothers, granddads, kinfolk. And I know they're pleased to have you here. And we had a great service last night. Brother McGee brought a great message last night. I'm looking forward to hearing him again tonight. Our young people, we said last night, fell in love with Brother McGee the first time he came and preached. And to my knowledge, Brother Steve will know maybe for sure, we've had, I guess, over the years now, probably hundreds of chapel speakers that have come and preached and had some good preaching. But when Brother McGee preached the first message here, I believe every student in the school came forward. I believe there was one that remained in their seat, came to this altar and prayed. To my knowledge, no one has ever touched their hearts as a school body like that before. And he's special to us, and we love him. And you that have not met him, you'll love him after tonight. Brother McGee, come preach for us.
Well, again, I'm grateful. Revelation chapter 20, verse number 11, the scripture says, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the heaven and the earth fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And The dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. The sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. They were judged every man according to their works. Death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Let's go to the Lord tonight again in prayer. Father, we thank you for the beautiful day and for the blessing and the privilege of being able to come here tonight. I thank you, Lord, for hearing your spirit. Already moved up in our hearts. And I pray that throughout the remainder of this service that it will continue to speak to each and every one of us. I pray that those of us who are saved will be challenged to be more committed to win souls to know you. I pray that those that are here tonight that are lost will be saved before they leave here this evening. In your name I pray. For your sake I pray. Amen. I believe the most agonizing day a lost person could ever experience will be that day whenever they'll stand in the presence of the Lord at the great white throne judgment. That's what I'm going to be preaching about tonight. I'm going to be preaching a message on the subject of the great white throne judgment. By way of introduction, I probably should say tonight that at the great white throne judgment, time is dead and eternity has begun. Calendar will not be turning and the clock will not be ticking at the great white throne judgment of the Lord. With that in mind tonight, I'm going to preach about the judgment, the fact of the judgment, the fairness of the judgment, and the finality of the judgment. I'm also going to preach tonight about the judge, the authority of the judge, the anger of the judge, and the acknowledgement that will be made to the judge. Then I'm going to preach tonight about the judged, the description of these people, the distress of these people, and the discovery of these people. But I want to begin tonight by preaching about the fact of the judgment, because the Bible does say that it is appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. Just as sure as you're sitting in this room tonight, one day, the great white throne judgment is going to take place. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, in Acts chapter 17, and verses 30 and 31, that he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained. Now, I don't know if any of you live by an appointed schedule or not, but I live by an appointed schedule. I've got a little red calendar book that I carry with me almost everywhere I go. Every day of my life, I look at this little red calendar book. If I've got something scheduled in the month of June, it must be recorded in this little red calendar book. If I've got something scheduled in the month of May, I must write it down in this little red calendar book. And I'm such a person that if I don't refer to this book on a regular basis, I'll forget about where I'm supposed to be going, and I'll forget about what I'm supposed to be doing. I live by an appointed schedule. Now, there are times where I change the appointments that I have scheduled in this red calendar book. For example, some time ago, my wife and I were both going to the dentist office one week. She was going on Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. I was going to go 2 days later on Thursday morning at 10 o'clock. Well, whenever Missy went to the dentist office, she come back home and she told me about the experience that she had there. She said that she was seated in the dentist chair, and he began to examine her teeth, and he found a cavity, and he was going to drill out that cavity and replace it with a filling. She told me that whenever he was drilling out that cavity, he hit a nerve, and she began to explain to me the excruciating pain. Whenever she did, I got up and I started to walk out of the living room into the kitchen. She said, "Wait a minute, I'm not finished yet." I said, "Oh, yes, you are." And I called the dentist office. And whenever the receptionist answered, I said, "Ma'am, this is Curtis McGee." She said, "Yes, I know who you are, but I thought your wife would already be home by now. She's been gone for about 30 minutes. I said, "My wife is home, but that's not why I'm calling. I'm calling to tell you that something has come up for Thursday morning, and I'm not going to be able to come in. I've got to be scheduled to do it." She said, "Would you like me to reschedule you for the following week?" I said, "No, ma'am. And whenever I get ready to come, I'll call you. Don't call me. I'll call you whenever I get ready to come." Now, there are times whenever I change the appointments that are written down in this little red calendar book. But I believe in the calendar and in the sovereign mind of God, there's a date circled whenever the great white throne judgment will take place. And I do not believe that the Lord will change his appointments like Curtis McGee changes his appointments. One day, the great white throne judgment is going to occur. Now, this judgment is going to be a very fair judgment. And I thought that I ought to mention that tonight, because quite often in these modern days in which we live, whenever a preacher preaches about judgment, or whenever he preaches about hell, sometimes someone will ask, well, do you really think that God would be fair to put heathen in a place called hell? Well, frankly, I believe that the Lord would be fair if he allowed all of us, whether we are heathen or not, to go to that place called hell. I do not believe that any of us are deserving of heaven. Yeah. But yes, this judgment is going to be a very fair judgment. Now, I realize that many times the judgments in our day, the courtrooms in our time, are not fair. We live in a day whenever sometimes juries will make mistakes in their deliberations. We live in a time whenever sometimes judges take bribes. We live in a time whenever, on occasion, witnesses will be called to the stand and they will tell a lie for the person who is on trial. But at the judgment that I'm preaching about, the jury will make no mistake because God is the one that has kept the record. The judge is not going to take any money under the table because he does not need any. And the witnesses will not be able to tell a lie for you because the Lord will not call any to the stand. You know, whenever I'm in revival meetings preaching the Word of God, whenever I get a chance to go out on visitation with the pastor, or whenever I'm visiting in my home community talking to people about the Lord, I hear excuses on a regular basis as to why people will not be saved. And the excuses that I hear more than any other excuse are these two excuses. Number one, I would be saved. But you know, there's so many hypocrites in religion today, I just don't want any part of it. The other excuse that I hear on a regular basis is this excuse. I am going to be saved, but I just don't want to get saved now. But I will get saved in some other place at some other time. But you know, according to the Bible in Romans chapter 1, verse number 20, in chapter 1, verse number 20, the Bible says that they are without excuse. If you go to the great white throne judgment, you're not going to be able to stand in the presence of the Lord and say, no one ever told me, because I'm telling you right now. You're not going to be able to say, no one ever warned you, because I'm warning you tonight. And you're not going to be able to say, you never had an opportunity to be saved, because you're going to have an opportunity to be saved before you leave here this evening. And I want to say to you that at the great white throne judgment, everything that's done will be done. Everything that's said will be said. The great white throne judgment is going to be a judgment of great finality. I've never been to Niagara Falls, but I do know people who have been there. One woman in my church went to the great Niagara Falls, and whenever she came back, she told me about her trip. And she said, Brother Curtis, just at the edge of that river, as it begins to make its turbulent plunge over the great Niagara Fall, there is a sign that says, past Redemption Point. Now I suppose what that sign means is that if you let your picnic basket get into that water, there's no need to try to save it. It's too late. If you let your children get into that raging river, there's no need to try to redeem them because, my friend, they are going to die. Well, at the great white throne judgment, you need to know that you're going to be past the point of redemption. And if you ever make a decision and change your mind about the decision that you've made, I do that on a regular basis. Once in a while, my wife and I will have a very serious discussion. And for those of you that don't know this, preachers and their wives don't argue and fuss and fight like other people do. We only have serious discussions. Now, some of you probably think that whenever my wife and I argue, we quote Bible scripture to one another. And Brother Steve and Sister Bonita may do that, I'm not sure. But I know one thing, whenever my wife and I are having a serious discussion, most of the time we're not quoting much scripture at one another. And sometimes we'll be having one of these discussions. And she'll say, you know, I think we're going to do it this way. I'll say, no, this way's a lot better. And she'll say, but just think about it. And I'll say, no, I think we ought to do it this way. Finally, after we discuss that for a while, I'll put my foot down. And I'll say, now listen, I'm the man of the house. And this is the way we're going to do it. It's the best way. And this is the way that it's going to be done. Well, I'll wake up at about 3 o'clock in the morning. And I'll think about everything I said and everything she said. And I'll realize that her way was 100 times better than my way could have ever been. But whenever we get up the next morning, I still try to save face, so to speak, you know. So whenever we get up the next morning, I'll say, Missy, I've been thinking about this, and I really believe my way is still the best way. But I love you so much, we're going to do it your way. Sometimes I do that. You men do the same. But you know, there are a lot of people who believe that they can live in this walk of life any way they want to live. They can lead this walk of life any way they want to live. They believe that whenever they stand in front of the Creator, there at Judgment Day, they'll be able to say, Lord, I know that I was lost, but I'm changing my mind. I want to get saved now. My friend, that'll never take place. I know in the courtrooms of America, whenever a person is found guilty, they usually take their case to a higher court and to a higher judge. But I'm not preaching about the supreme judge. I'm preaching about the divine judge. I'm preaching about a courtroom where there will be no plea bargaining. I'm preaching about a courtroom where there will be no appeals. If you go to the great white throne judgment, you'll never hear another singer sing another song like you've heard tonight. You'll never hear testimonies like these again. You'll never hear a preacher preach another sermon from the Word of God. If you go to the great white throne judgment, you will be lost for all of eternity. And friends, that's settled. You'll never be saved if you go to the great white throne judgment of the Lord. Some of you are asking, preacher, who has the authority? Who's going to be the judge? Some of you are going to take issue with what I'm about to say, so I'll back it up with the Word of God. But I want to tell you that the judge is going to be none other than the Lord Jesus Christ himself. You say, preacher, I don't believe that. Well, the Bible says in John 5:22 that the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. You say, he's not worthy. Oh, yes, he is. Revelation 4:11 says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive Amen. Glory and honor and power. He is worthy to be the judge. And I'm going to say something else about this judge. He's going to be there on Judgment Day. He's not dead like some have said. He is alive and well, and he will be present whenever this judgment takes place. You know, I get amazed at Baptist people preaching revivals on Easter Sundays, and I always notice one thing about Easter. People come to church on Easter Sunday that never come to church any other time of the year. I always notice that whenever people come on Easter Sunday, they really deck out to come to the house of God. I mean, men will get these pink coats and these black pocket handkerchiefs with a red tie. And the women will get their fancy and frilly dresses and their hats, and they all come to the house of God. And many of them come to the house of God and they sit down in the church pew, have no intention of being saved, no intention of ever being faithful to God. If you were to go to them as a preacher and say, listen, why have you chosen to come to church on Easter Sunday? The majority of them would say, well, the reason that I've chosen to come to church on Easter Sunday is because I wanted to celebrate the resurrection of the Savior. But I want to tell you something tonight, friend. The only time you come to church is on Easter Sunday and graduation services. You might be just as well off to get yourself a black suit and bury yourself in a coffin somewhere on Easter as you had to come into the house of God. Because the same Lord that you're coming to celebrate the resurrection of is going to be the Lord that will be your judge on Judgment Day. Amen. And according to the Bible, the Lord is angry with the wicked every day. You know, I've seen judges in the courtrooms there in Muhlenberg County, and I notice how they handle their cases. And the judge always looks the same. Anytime I've ever been to the courtroom, he always looks the same every time the chairman of the jury pronounces the verdict. Doesn't matter if the chairman says guilty or not guilty, that judge is always cool and calm and collected, but the judge that I'm preaching about is not going to be that way. Friend, I believe that his eyes will flash like fire. I believe that through the judgment hall, his voice will sound like thunder. Yes, he is a merciful Savior today, but he is going to be a raging judge in the day that I'm preaching about. You know, whenever I was in school, by the way, I didn't cover anything like that, but I was excited about these young people. I heard about them. They made 17 100s during the school year, something like that. Another one made 20-something hundreds during the school year. I only made 100. I mean, 100 during my entire 12 years of school. Mother was proud of me then because she asked me what I'd made at the end. I said 50 in math and 50 in science. I never did go to school at all. But I remember I did wake up one time in literature class, and my teacher assigned me this subject. She said, I want you to read a sermon out of the literature book. Well, I wasn't saved and I wasn't too excited about that, but as I began to read this sermon, it caught my attention right away. The title of the sermon was Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And it was preached many years ago by a preacher, a very powerful preacher, by the name of Jonathan Edwards. And the Bible does say that it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. And I read about how that Jonathan Edwards described so vividly men being cast into the lake of fire. And I read how that he described so vividly and accurately and scripturally the judgment of God. And I read how that Jonathan Edwards was preaching that sermon in a northeastern city in America one night. And there was a congregation filled with people. And it was said that while he was preaching the sermon, all over the building, people were weeping as he was delivering that message. in the middle of his message, there was a man in the back of the building who jumped up to his feet, and he said, Jonathan Edwards, wait a minute. Jonathan Edwards quit preaching. He said, sir, what is it that you want? That man looked at Jonathan Edwards and he said, Jonathan Edwards, you've told us about the anger of God and you've told us about the vengeance and the wrath of the Lord, but why have you not explained to us the mercy and the love and the grace of God? Jonathan Edwards said, sir, I want to tell you something. If you're going to hear about mercy and grace and love, I'd better preach about it now. Because in the day in which I'm preaching about, although God will love you, and although he will still be a God of mercy and a God of grace, you're going to see something out of the Lord during that day that you're not hearing a great deal about during these times. I want to tell you that at the great white throne judgment, he is going to be extremely angry. And according to the book of Philippians chapter 2 and verses 9, 10, and 11, there will be an acknowledgement made to the judge, because the Bible says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. Every homosexual is going to bow someday. Every drug addict is going to bow someday. Every confessing church member that did not know the Lord as Savior is going to bow in the presence of the Lord someday. You know, I've read about men like Hitler. They tell me that Hitler could say just 4 or 5 words, and whenever he would speak, they would put a multitude of Jews into the gas chamber where they would be persecuted until death. They say that whenever men approached Hitler, they had to get on their knees and bow before him as though he were the Lord. One of these days, Hitler is going to bow in the presence of the real Lord. Right, I'm going to tell you something tonight, friend. You may not come here tonight and bow, but you are going to bow someday. You may not stand up here and confess tonight, but you are going to confess someday. But the only problem is, whenever they confess then, they're going to confess unto damnation and not unto salvation. It's going to be too late then to be saved. You say, preacher, who's going to be at this judgment? Give us a description of these people. Well, I believe that all of the perverted and all of the winos and all of the wicked down through the years are going to be there. All of the perverted and prostitutes and pimps are going to be there. All of the maniacs and all of the murderers are going to be there. They'll come there from every country, every color, and every creed. I believe there will be people there that are 8 years old, and I believe there will be people there that are 108 years old. They're going to come there from every walk of life. And I believe that all of the wicked are going to be there, but I want to say something else. There are going to be some religious people at this judgment that I'm preaching about. I believe they're going to be evangelists and pastors and deacons at the great white throne judgment of the Lord. Not because they were evangelists, not because they were pastors or deacons, not because they were involved with religion, but because they never did know the Lord as their personal Savior. You ever thought about what happens to people whenever they die and go to heaven? You know, the Bible says in verse number 13, and I believe here people are going to make a discovery of distress. The Bible says, and the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. I can show you from the Word of God that whenever a person dies, if they're lost, as soon as they die, they go to hell. You say, what about purgatory? Never read about that in the Bible.
Right. Yeah.
What about spiritual limbo? There's no such thing.
Right.
What about a long, dark tunnel, and at the end of the tunnel of life, that represents peace and prosperity? No, sir. If you die lost without Jesus, you're going to this place called heaven. Now, if you die and you're saved, according to the Bible, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. But do you understand that according to what the Bible says, that there's going to be at least a short period of time when those people will get out of hell? You know, I've often thought about Judas Iscariot. Judas Iscariot, by the way, was a lost man. You say, preacher, Judas Iscariot repented. You study that out and you'll find out Judas only repented himself. The Bible says that the devil was of Judas Iscariot and Judas was of the devil. You say, but preacher, Judas was saved. No, I don't believe that a man would repent and a few hours later put a noose around his neck and jump to his death. I just don't believe that. Not a few hours later, I believe Judas would have been happy if he would have been saved. Judas died and went to hell. Someone said that they could imagine that in hell there's Judas Iscariot. One of these days, so to speak, the gates of hell are going to spring open. They wondered if Judas Iscariot might say to some harlot, I want you to look. The gates of hell are coming open. I want you to look. The harlot will turn to some darkness. She'll say, look, the gates are opening up. Judas is going to come out of hell, but whenever he does, he's going into a courtroom. He's going before the throne. Seated upon the throne is not a lamb, but a lion from the tribe of Judah. The recording angel brings the book, the Lamb's Book of Life. The Lord opens it up and he looks at Judas and he says, Judas, I want to know something. Is your name in the book? I can imagine that Judas will say, no, Lord. I'm not for sure if my name's in the book or not. I don't know about all that, but Lord, I preach the good stuff. Judas, is your name in this book? That's what I want to know, is your name in this book? Can you imagine Judas' knees begin to knock together? As his lips begin to tremble? And he says, Lord, I've been burning there for hundreds of years. I don't want to go back to that terrible place. I've been weeping and crying and gnashing my teeth. And Lord, I don't want to go back there. But is your name in the book? Judas will have to bow in the presence of the Lord. He's going to have to say, no, Lord, my name's not in that book. The Lord's going to say to him, depart from me, ye that work iniquity, into that lake of fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels. I never did know you. Friend, there's only one thing that matters when you leave this walk of life. Doesn't matter how many scripture verses you've learned. Doesn't make a difference how many times you've observed the Lord's Supper. Doesn't make any difference how many years you've stood before the Sunday school class to teach the Word of God. The only thing that matters whenever you leave this walk of life is whether or not your name has been recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life. I was reading some time ago about a great Methodist evangelist by the name of Sam Jones. Sam Jones was a very powerful preacher, dynamically preached the Word of God. Sam Jones had come in from the revival trail, and there was a congregation of people that gathered on the outside of his home. They knocked at his door, and Sam Jones opened the door, and he opened it up. The people said to him, Sam, our sheriff is dying. The doctor said that he's going to be dead in a matter of hours, and as you know, he's never been saved, and we were wondering if you would come and talk to him about being saved tonight. Preacher Sam said, listen, I witnessed him over and over again. I've talked to him probably a dozen times about being saved, and he never indicated to me that he wanted to be saved. There's no need for me to go and talk to him now. But after the persistence of the people, Sam Jones finally went. He got his coat and his hat and went out into the night and walked down the street until he came to the sheriff's home. Whenever he walked into the sheriff's room, the bedroom of the sheriff was laying there on his deathbed. Sam Jones noticed there was a nurse standing on one side of the bed, and there on the other side of the bed was the wife of this sheriff. They stepped out and he said, I knelt there beside him and I began to talk to him about going to heaven. He said, but as I would talk to him, he just kind of shake his head and gasp for breath as I would speak to him about death and about heaven. Finally, I said, Sheriff, I know you want to go to heaven whenever you die. He said, that sheriff looked at me. He said, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. He said, now wait a minute, Sheriff. You're not telling me that you want to go to hell whenever you die. He said, that sheriff looked at me. He said, doesn't matter. Just doesn't matter. Sam Jones said, I felt impressed of the Lord to open my Bible to the book of Revelation, chapter 20, verse number 11. He said, I began to read those verses. I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the heaven and the earth fled away. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. Sam Jones said, I read those verses and I explained to him the great white throne judgment. And I said to him, Sheriff, one of these days you're going to give an account of every word you've ever said, every thought you've ever had, every deed you've ever done. You better get saved. He said, the spirit of conviction come upon that sheriff. He said, as near to death as he was, he sat up on his deathbed and he looked at me. He said, about heaven, I thought I could stand to miss it. And I thought about hell and I thought I could stand to go there. But I've never thought about standing in the presence of the Lord, giving an account of everything I've ever done someday. I don't think I could stand that. He said, preacher, I want to be saved. Some of you here that are just like that dying sheriff. You've been in church, you've had people witness to you, you've thought about heaven and you thought, well, maybe I could stand to miss it. You've thought about hell and you thought, maybe I could stand to go there. But I want to know something tonight. Have you ever thought about standing in the presence of a holy Lord, giving an account of all of your evil deeds and all of your sin? It'll happen someday if you're not saved. And I know, yes, the righteous are going to appear there at the judgment seat of Christ. I understand that. But I'm preaching tonight about the great white throne judgment. Friend, if you're lost without Jesus, you mark it down. You listen carefully. Unless you get saved, you're going to this judgment I preached about. It'll be a million times worse than what you ever dreamed. I want to ask you to bow your head with me tonight and close your eyes for just a few moments, if you will. I'm going to ask someone to come to lead us in singing, someone to come to play the piano. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed across this building, no one looking around. My Christian friend, you understand your loved ones are going to this judgment that I've preached about tonight that I've been saved. Maybe this message ought to cause us to have a vision. Maybe we ought to be more concerned in days to come than we've ever been before about people that are lost. Maybe you ought to just come and pray for lost loved ones. Maybe you ought to come and pray, Lord, move upon my heart that I might be more dedicated as a soul winner in days to come. And then there are people here tonight that are lost. If you were to die right now, you'd go to hell and someday be called out to stand in the presence of the Lord in that courtroom that I've been preaching about. And I want you to know you don't have to go there. One good thing about hell, no one has to go there. You can be saved because Jesus loves you because he died for your sins. He'd rather be your savior than your judge. Father, tonight, I pray your Holy Spirit move upon the service in such a tremendous way that none of us, oh Lord, could grieve him or quench him. Oh God, would you give us a vision? Lord, will you let us see like John saw? Dead, small, and great stand before you. You let us see our neighbors, our families, and our friends being cast into a lake of fire someday. Father, will you break our hearts? Oh God, will you stir our souls and our spirits? Father, for those that are lost tonight, please convict them of their sin. They might come and be saved this evening. In your name I pray. I want us to all stand together for the will of peace. Someone will come to counsel with you if you want to be saved. Just stand up and pray. Would you do as we sing what number we've done? 270. As we sing, when you come. Savior. We say, preacher, get saved at a graduation service. certainly what better place to get saved. Last time I preached in graduation service, there was someone saved. You can be saved tonight. I want you to be honest with me. I want you to be honest with yourself, and more importantly, I want you to be honest with God. If you're here tonight and you've never been saved, all I'm going to do is pray for you. Would you lift up your hand and hold it high right now and keep it held up where I can see it? Keep it held up where I can see it. Preacher, I wish you would pray for me because I've never been saved. Just put your hand up in the air high right now so I can see it. I promise you, I'm not going to embarrass you, friend. I want you to be saved. Let me ask you this question. If you're here tonight and you know you're saved, if you were to die right now, you know that you would go to heaven. Would you lift up your hand and hold it in the air? If you know you're saved, keep it held up because it's going to take me a few minutes to look around the building. You may put your hands down. Now, I couldn't see everywhere, but I could see that there were some who could not lift up their hand. Now, I realize that I've only saw your hands and that God sees your heart. Friend, there's no reason for you to leave your lost tonight. Maybe you need to come and get right with the Lord. Maybe you need to come and just have a time of prayer here in the altar. Maybe it's been a while since you've done that, but whatever the need is, would you respond tonight? Father, as we continue to sing, I pray that you'll continue to bless the service. I pray especially for those who could not lift up their hand. I pray that these will come to be saved tonight. In your name I pray. Amen. Step out and come to the front of the building right now. Would you do that?
Saved, the Bible teaches us the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. He uses the Word of God to touch our hearts. My dad was in a revival meeting years ago. He was lost. He was a drunk. The man preached the Word of God with power like you've heard tonight. My dad left the service lost and went home lost. Went to bed that night, but sleep had left him. He could not sleep. He tossed and turned until finally he slid out of bed, down on his knees, and asked the Lord to save him. The Lord gave me a Christian daddy. Then he made a preacher out of that saved drunk. Gave me a preacher daddy. God loves every person here tonight, and God's not willing that any should perish. God wants everybody to be saved. And I pray that tonight, before you close your eyes for sleep, you'd make the steps necessary in your heart and your life to prepare you for the great white throne judgment. or prepare you to miss the great white throne judgment. You don't have to go if you're saved. Only the lost will be there. We thank you for your presence tonight. Won't you get around and congratulate these that have graduated, the little ones and the big ones. And we know that they're proud of your presence here. Let's bow our heads and be dismissed. And we'll have, refreshments in the trailers after we're dismissed. And we talk with the graduates over there. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for
church, he looks at me and he goes, You did a good job, Sheriff.
Thank you.
You're a teacher.
I
Kelly? Each of my brother looked like Rick Jones.
Thank you. Renee?
Thank you.
Now let me get one more. picture of you yet tonight. I haven't got a picture of you yet tonight.
We're getting ready to get in there now.
Where's that light? Where you supposed to be in that light?
Shoot.
Ha ha ha.